Okay, hi guys, and welcome to the show. Today we're going to be talking about the dangers of buying used or vintage chronographs. And this comes about from my own experience restoring this beautiful little Britix Swiss chronograph. Now, of course, before I get into this video, I'll do a very quick wristwatch check. I'm wearing my beloved Navi timer, the blue dial Navi timer. And it's funny, I've been just thinking about my Submariner a lot because I'm trying to decide to keep it or not. One thing I have noticed about the Navi timer, I've never, ever, ever considered selling it. And that's strange because it's not my favorite watch, but I guess it's just a solid keeper. But as we're discussing chronographs today, I thought I'll wear this one also to match the blue shirt. Of course. Anyway, guys, wristwatch check done. Let's roll the intro and get into today's video. Okay, that's not actually coffee, that's whiskey. No, I'm joking, it is coffee. So, where should we start? Well, I guess we should start with the watch itself. So this is a 1950s Britix chronograph. The movement inside is a Landeron 48. I was inspired to buy this from, I've got to say, it started a lot earlier last year. I saw this amazing poster, and if I can find it, I'll share it with you guys. A beautiful kind of 1940s car whizzing through the air, and it just looks so elegant. I adore cars of that period, the 30s, 40s, 50s, up until the 60s, the roadsters of the 30s, the Cadillacs of the 50s, even Lincolns of the 60s. I mean, just truly beautiful works of art and so stylish and elegant. God knows what's happened to cars these days. And not to mention the British cars, like Rolls-Royce and Bugatti, of course, if we look at the continent. But anyway, before I rabbit on about beautiful old motor cars, I saw this poster and I was really inspired by this brand. I wasn't aware of it. It is now an extinct brand. It doesn't exist anymore, sadly. And guys, if you know anything about Britix in particular, please do share down below. I couldn't really find out that much about them. Possibly they had a relationship with Breitling. But again, I couldn't find concrete evidence. They're definitely Swiss, but what struck me was obviously the elegance of the poster. I love advertising of that era. There's a romance about it. There's a beauty, there's an elegance, there's a style. Just things were so stylish back then. So I always kept an eye out, and lo and behold, I found this beautiful little chronograph. So what immediately struck me about the piece was, first of all, I love the bi-compact layout. The red second hand kind of corresponds with the telemeter scale beautifully, and the blue, again, of the blued hands matches the tachymeter. Even the Britix logo, I love how it's slanted inwards. Very deco-ish in style, although, you know, this is from a later period. The printing on the dial is very crisp, the patinaed numerals, completely original, which is the main thing I really appreciate about this. It's got very nice flat pushers, brushed on the side, and then a high polish on the bezel. And we do have some rather nice beveled edges on the lugs. So it's a 17 jewel movement, rhodium plated, 30 minute chronograph. The Landeron 48, produced from Landeron from about 1937 all the way to 1970, which is crazy. And in fact, there were 3.5 million of this caliber produced. In terms of how it wears, it's so minute, it almost wears a little bit like a date just. It's about 12 millimeters high, 41 millimeters from lug to lug, and only 34 millimeters in diameter. Of course, typical of its day, these days far too small, but for me, absolutely perfect. It's chrome plated, which I prefer solid stainless steel, but nevertheless, most of the original components were there, including the movement. The only thing that had been replaced was the crown. Unfortunately, the crown they replaced it with was far too big. So I decided, I gave them a very, an offer they couldn't refuse. And lo and behold, I won the auction. So when it arrived, everything was functioning fine, although the chronograph wasn't zeroing correctly. In terms of keeping time, it works perfectly fine. I decided, I really want to see this as close to the original. I'll send it in, I'll have it serviced, I'll have the crown replaced to something a little bit more fitting. I did a little bit of research on this model. Again, there wasn't really much out there, so I had to go by pictures of very similar Britix chronographs. Every single crown I saw was different, and this is very common with vintage watches. But the insight and the feedback I got from Saltzmans, and Saltzmans, if you guys are not aware, they're based in Rhode Island. Actually, I think they have a few locations. They are my watchmakers of choice. They recently serviced a Tudor, an ETA based Tudor for me. And I must make this very, very clear. I hire them myself. I'm a paying customer because if I love it, I buy it. If I hire somebody to do some work, I pay them. I always put my money where my mouth is. So this is no promotion in any way. If you want my recommendation, of course, I'm going to refer to them because they have an expertise. And actually, you'll see right now, Richard, shout out to my friend Richard at Saltzmans for allowing me to pester him with so many questions. And he wrote back to me a ton of notes. A good watchmaker, certainly like the guys at Saltzmans, they have years and years of experience, and that's what it's so important. Anyway, before I get into this more technical aspect of what to keep in mind, do have a look back at the video. I'll add a link in the description down below of 10 questions you must ask whenever you're buying from a watch dealer, maybe eBay, Chrono 24, that kind of thing. So let's just pretend for a moment you've found the watch you're looking for. You're happy that the seller is reputable. You've worked out, it's in your budget. You've worked out it's the one you want. You've done the research. But what do you need to know about chronographs? Well, what movements should you look out for? What kind of costs of servicing are we looking at? And these things vary so much. So I thought I'd share what Richard has so kindly sent to me and what I've learned from restoring this. Now, I haven't quite finished restoring the Britix. Unfortunately, one of the hammers inside the landeron needs to be replaced. It looks like the movement needs a service, and that's not going to be cheap. It's going to be about $400-$500. Is it worth restoring it to its former glory? I think it is. I mean, the crown, I only paid $45 so far. I think the new crown that I've replaced it with is a lot more fitting to the scale of the watch. The chaps at Saltzmans tried various different types, but this ended up being the best because it's large enough to get purchased, to actually get a good grip on it, and suited the style the best. Another watch, another chronograph, vintage chronograph, I sent into Saltzmans. This is my Dubé and Chaldemarin split time chronograph. It's a retrapant with the index mobile complication. Now, that only needed a little bit of work, one of the hands to be reset. So it was fairly easy. So I asked, my first question was, what is the difference between obtaining parts for, because they're both Landeron based, in something like this from the 40s in the Britix, which is the 48, and the caliber 248 in the Dubé and Chaldemarin. So Richard said that obtaining the parts, there pretty much isn't really that much of a difference. What really separates them is the De Beir and Chaldon brand, of course, has the split time, the index mobile retrepant complication, which is done in-house, or was done in-house, by De Beir and Chaldon brand. So if there's an issue with that, or parts need to be replaced with the index mobile complication, that's going to have to be done by De Beir and Chaldon brand. That's going to be tricky, because it is, of course, a complication developed by them and installed by De Beir and Chaldon brand. So that's a very important key point to remember. If it has any extra complications, especially in-house complications, that's going to make it more difficult, more expensive to repair, especially something as so unique as the index mobile. Now, I am aware of this. The magic of the watch, it's just worth it. But anyway, do bear that in mind. So I asked about what vintage movements, specifically chronograph movements, were the best in terms of affordability and in servicing, and which is a better buy or ones to stay away from. So Richard replied, most of the chronograph movements of this era, so we're talking 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s, right? Most of the base chronograph movements from this era are all about the same in terms of parts availability and ease of service. In fact, they are generally have better parts available than some of the early quartz and electric movements from the early 70s. Many early quartz movements, especially from the Swiss, were proprietary. If you remember, I think we talked about the Rolex quartz movements at some point. But anyway, it would be about another decade before quartz got standardized and were getting used across the brands industry-wide. Valjoux and Lemagne probably have the slight edge in terms of parts and availability since the brands existed and were manufactured so long. Certain Venus calibers like the 188 also have some parts that are interchangeable with the Valjoux 7730 series of movements. So let's not forget, and that's because Valjoux acquired Venus, I think in the late 60s, if I recall correctly. So Richard mostly recommends watches with the Venus 188 or the Valjoux 7730 series, simply because of this. It's gonna be a lot more affordable to service and replace any parts that may need replacing. Now, this is an interesting point. Richard says, also for the younger generation of watchmaker who may not have experienced the vast array of vintage calibers, the architecture of the 188 or the 7730 is so similar to the modern day 7750, which we all love. Where is my, oh, I'm wearing the 7750 in my, well, Breitling's chronometer grade version of it in my Navi timer. It's definitely one of the easiest to service. And actually it's made me kind of, especially reading and all the talking with Richard and everything I've been learning about vintage chronographs, I'm starting to really appreciate the Valjoux 7750. I know I criticize it for being too tall, but at least you spend $1,000 on a Hamilton or a couple of thousand on a Breitling, or even I saw a Universal Genève going for 1300 with their caliber 98, which is basically a 7750. And I was thinking, you know, I used to kind of think, oh, it's a bit boring, but after learning all about this, certainly a lot less of a worry owning, and you know, they are troopers, let's not forget. Obviously, the longer a company has been out of business, the harder it gets to obtain parts. The more of one particular caliber is made, generally the better supply. Also, the longer a movement is made, generally the better quality and more plentiful the parts supply will be. Some of the chronograph movements developed in the late 30s and early 40s were still being used well over decades later, which we've certainly talked about many, many times. And speaking of parts, most of the parts obtained with these movements, Landeron, Venus, Lemagne, etc., are NOS, new old stock. There are no modern factories still making these parts for these discontinued movements. The supply of complete movements dried up years ago for the most part. These NOS parts were manufactured, you know, 60 plus years ago and have been sitting in storage. The parts supply market of these movements tend to be more plentiful in Europe, which is why watch pairs take so long sometimes. I knew that this was going to take a while. I left this with them over Christmas. I was gone for a month, you know, well, actually, well, a bit over a month. They scour the globe and they use their connections and they bring the watches parts in, and I really appreciate that. So always, guys, always bear that in mind. It might take a little while longer. The supply is also finite. Unless modern manufacturers decide to reissue one of their older movements and start making parts again, which is highly unlikely. With finite supply, the first step in the supply chain is supply houses, wholesalers. It then dwindles down to independent repair facilities like Saltzmans, who have developed their own hoard of parts. You know, good, which is another reason why I always go to Saltzmans. Who have developed their own hoard of parts over the years and are willing to sell them openly on the market to one another. From there, individual collectors, antique buyers, and people retired from the industry sell parts they have also hoarded as well. So always keep any parts of old watches around. You never know when it's going to be valuable. There is a market for used parts as well, from watches that have simply been scrapped. But generally speaking, used parts are always the last resort. Believe it or not, one of the most difficult things on a vintage chronograph of this era is not movements, but case parts. Unfortunately, the metallurgy from this era was not too great. My little Britix is a perfect example, it being chrome plated and not as solid as stainless steel. And after 60 years, it flakes, much more prone to corrosion. And in fact, there is a tiny bit of corrosion on my case as well. Cases, case backs and pushers especially are the most difficult parts to source and replace. So I then asked Richard for a few pointers, things to look out for when buying vintage chronographs. He said shop simple as possible. A straightforward chronograph will be easier, cheaper, faster to service than one with added complications like moon phases, calendars, split seconds, etc. Pay close attention to the case parts, the parts condition, especially pushers. If the case is heavily worn, cracked or pitted away, look out for these things. If the chrono pusher is bent or damaged, stay away. Case parts can often be harder to source than movement parts. I always presumed it was the other way around. Very interesting. If you can buy a piece that was recently serviced and good working condition, go for that one. Many of these vintage chronos can be had for a song under $300. But keep in mind that a full service, if required, can easily cost more than what is spent on the watch. Certainly true of mine. I'm prepared to pay it because I think it's such a darling little chronograph. It deserves to be rescued, and you might not be willing to pay $400-$500 extra on a piece. At that price, you know, if you're already paying $300, it's creeping up to, you know, $800-$1,000. You might as well just buy a brand new Hamilton with a 7750 in it. Anyway, so bear that in mind. Most independent service facilities will charge somewhere in the range of $400-$600 for a full service. Especially on a hand-wound vintage chronographs like mine. It is also common for vintage chronographs to need additional parts and a full service. Hammers and hammer springs especially, which is what mine needs. The wear and a loose tension can mount up over the years. So the last point is talk to your local watchmaker or service facility. Over their career, a watchmaker will develop a certain fondness or familiarity with certain movements. Maybe they have their own part supply or suppliers that tend to favor one manufacturer over another. Having a relationship with an experienced watchmaker is so important. And this is why I recommend Saltzmans. And this is why I personally hire and pay for all my repairs with these guys, because they have the expertise, they have the connections, they have the ability to source parts. At the end of the day, they're professional. It might take a little while longer if parts are a bit more scarce. Most importantly, thank you to Richard. I'm learning stuff, and this is, you know, especially a watch enthusiast like me, it's just a pleasure to learn this stuff. Anyway, guys, I think I'm going to leave it there. I'm gonna have to save up a little bit of. I've just bought an AP. It was Christmas not so long ago. So spending $500 on servicing this is not at the top of my priority list, but I will be eventually. I hope this was useful to you. Do share any little bits of expertise or recommendations in the comments below. Yeah, it's been fun. It certainly has been fun. And guys, oh my God, this thing. It is worth it. To me, it is worth it. I'm very happy with this little Britix. I don't know if it's a keeper. I'm just enjoying restoring it. There's a certain amount of satisfaction about it. And of course, I had to put it on this regimental NATO. Just works perfectly. Anyway, guys, I'm rabbiting on. I'll leave it there. Thank you so much for watching. Thank you especially to Saltzmans and my friend Richard for the wonderful insight into vintage chronographs. Please don't forget to add your thoughts, queries, comments, opinions, all the rest of it down below. Thank you so much for watching. Please don't forget to like this video if you enjoyed it and found it useful. And as always, guys, I will catch you in the next one. Okay, ciao.
Here's the first of the day, fellas. To old D.H. Lawrence.